Good morning, everyone. Today I will demonstrate an experiment of viscosity. The aim of the experiment is to verify Stokes' law and to determine the coefficient of viscosity of the given liquid, which in our case is glycerin. So to start with, let's have a brief introduction of the viscosity. So when a solid slides over another solid, we know that friction comes into action, which tries to oppose the motion of the solid. Similarly, in case of liquids, when liquid starts flowing, then there is a relative motion between the different layers of the liquid and a tangential opposing force acts between the different layers of the same liquid. This is actually the internal frictional force, which is also known as the viscous force. So this viscous force tries to reduce any velocity gradient among the various layers of the liquid. So this is given by F is equal to eta A dV by dx, where dV by dx is the velocity gradient, A is the area of the layers in contact, eta is the coefficient of viscosity, which will be different for different liquids, and it is measured in decapoise. Its MKS unit is Newton second per meter square. Now we take a specific case because we have to verify the Stokes' law. So according to Stokes' law, when a solid is moving in an infinite column of liquid, the liquid layers which are in contact with the solid also move along with it, whereas the liquid which is far away from it, that is at rest. So there is a relative motion between the different layers of the liquid, and so the dragging force comes into existence, which is equal to 6 pi eta rv. As this relation suggests that this force depends on velocity v, and as the body is falling under gravity, its v will continue to increase. So it means the viscous force will also increase. However, it can increase up to a limit, and after that this becomes equal to the driving force of the body. So at that time the velocity, there is no force acting on that solid, and the solid moves with a constant velocity, which is known as terminal velocity of that body. So we are taking that into consideration. So Stokes gave a law for that, a relation for that, in which the solid is taken in form of a spherical balls. So if we look at this picture, so let us say this is a liquid column and this is a solid spherical ball which is falling freely under this column. So this column, actually it should be of infinite depth and infinite extent. So when it is falling, a weight of the body is acting downwards, and upthrust is acting upwards because it is in a liquid, and then this dragging force, because of the relative motion of the liquid layers, comes into action. So this is viscous force acting upwards, upthrust acting upwards, and the weight of the body acting downwards. So when the body attains terminal velocity, F plus U, upward acting force, is equal to downward acting force, which is M into G. So this F is the upthrust, which is the force due to the displaced liquid. So this is equal to 4 by 3 pi R cube sigma G, where sigma is the density of the liquid. And this M can be written as 4 by 3 pi r cube rho, where rho is the density of the spherical balls and r is the radius of the spherical ball. So when we solve this equation, we get the expression for coefficient of viscosity, which is 2 by 9 rho minus sigma g r square upon v t. So this is our working formula. However, we make some, we can measure this v t. But when we measure the VT with the help of our setup, that is not the exact VT. We have to apply some corrections to it. Why? Because assumed our liquid column is not of infinite depth. Secondly, we are measuring it in a column of the liquid, whereas we need an infinite extent for that. So two corrections are made for this. One is for the depth, and other is for the radius of this tube. So these are known as Ledenberg's correction. So our corrected value of velocity is equal to v dash, which we measured practically here, 1 plus 2.4 r upon capital R, 1 plus 3.3 r upon h, where h is the depth of the liquid and r is the radius of the liquid column. So this is about the theory of the experiment. Now let us see how the experiment is performed. So this is our experimental setup. We have a 1 meter long glass tube which is graduated and in which our experimental liquid glycerin is filled. We can see that it is graduated, but we have also marked at 20 centimeter, 30 centimeter and then 80 and 90 centimeters to guide us that when we have to switch on or off our stopwatch. So the travel time between these points will be measured. After that, to perform our experiment, we will require spherical balls. So to minimize the error, we have taken the balls of three sizes and three balls of each size. The radius of the balls will be measured with the help of a screw gauge, which will be explained in a separate video. Next, we require to measure the internal diameter of the glass tube to do our Ladenburg's correction. This is also will be explained in with the help of vernier calipers, which will be explained in a separate video. Now, to start our experiment, we will take one ball of one size and then measure its radius with the screw gauge, and before releasing it in the liquid, we will get it wetted with the experimental liquid so that there is no air gap and the solid is in direct contact with the liquid. It is then released in the liquid gently, and our stopwatch is also ready. So as it reaches 20 centimeter mark, I will switch on the stopwatch. So this is released, and now I have switched on this watch, and then I will switch it off when it reaches 80 centimeter and the time will be taken. So this will be repeated for all the balls of all the sizes. So after taking the readings, we fill up this table. This is one set of ball, that is a bigger ball say, and the middle size ball and the small size ball. We take the radius, mean radius of all the balls of one size here, the other size and the third size. Then we note down the time of fall of each ball of this size, and then mean is taken. So you have to be careful that you take the average of one sized balls and the time also of one sized balls. From these two values, we calculate the velocity, because the length of the column is known to us. That is around 80 centimeter, 60 centimeter, and this is our velocity, which has to be corrected by Ladenburg's correction. So we calculate this. For this, we know the radius, internal radius of the column. H is the height below the we measure the distance and time. So these two corrections are done. When we have this this set of velocity, we make another table in which we write the mean radius, corresponding r square and the velocity which we got from here. Okay? Then a plot between v and r square is done. So we found that this r square v graph comes out to be a straight line, which proves that Stokes' law is verified. Because from this formula, from the formula of the Stokes eta, it is eta is equal to 2 by 9 r square rho minus sigma g upon v. So this, because sigma v r square, these all are constant, so v square upon g, that comes out to be constant. It means r square upon v, sorry, that comes out to be constant. It means that it is a straight lines. It means that it is verified. Okay, so from there we take out the slope and then multiply it by r square of v and get the eta. So this is how we calculate the coefficient of viscosity. So we will discuss the precautions we have to keep while performing the experiment. First is that the radius of the sphere should be taken with utmost care, because it comes in terms of r square in the formula of eta, so it will increase the error if we make any mistake. Secondly, before the balls are dropped in the liquid, they should be thoroughly wetted in the experimental liquid so that there is no air in between. Third is that if the because we know that viscosity changes with temperature, so we should maintain a constant temperature while performing the experiment. That's all about this experiment. Thank you and have a nice day.